Christ is risen. This is the reason we gather as Christians, because Jesus has defeated death and we are alive in him. Because he lives, we shall live also. It's a joy to be here, to gather with you today, to rejoice in this good news of our Savior's resurrection, to be with those who are worshiping online and gathering with us. Praise God that he has sent his Son to die and rise for us. Let's stand and sing our first song.
Thank you.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
The stone has been rolled away. Hallelujah. He has conquered death by the cross.
He has come out of the tomb.
All glory, laud, and honor belong to you, O Lord. Alleluia.
We shall worship, praise, and glory, O Christ. Alleluia.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus has come that we may have life and have it to the fullest.
Christ has died.
He died for our sins.
The Scriptures testify to the will of God.
In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
Christ is risen.
He rose from the grave. For Christ must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death.
Christ will come again.
He bears the salvation of God.
The victory won for us, all believers.
God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. Let all the creatures of the earth shout.
Amen. He is risen from the dead.
All the saints and angels shout.
Amen. Christ is triumphed.
And the people of the Lamb shout.
Amen. We have the victory. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Almighty God, the Father, through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, you have overcome death and opened the gate of everlasting life to us. Grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of our Lord's resurrection may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we hear from God's Word. Our first lesson comes through the words of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all people a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." This is the word of the Lord. We hear Paul's words as he writes them to Christians in the city of Corinth. "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and then he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And by his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. Please stand as we hear the words of our Lord's resurrection. Gospel of Mark. When the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of the Lord. We join together in confessing our faith in our God who has died and risen for us. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit to the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, in the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated as we sing.
Thank you. Christ is risen.
He is
risen indeed. Hallelujah. When I'm not liturgist, I don't get as much chance to say that, so I had to put that in. And I offered to Pastor Rago that he could preach for Easter if he wanted. Nope. Okay. I'll take it. Man, what a wonderful day. It's so good to have you here, to have a church filled in to sing This Is the Feast together and to play the Zimbelstern and beat the drums. Ah. I'm so glad to be here with you. We've come to the end of our journey, right? You remember? Well, let me catch you up. Not everybody has been here. Some of you are guests. Some have been here, but you know, not everybody really clicks with the sermon series thing or necessarily sees all the pieces connecting. When we do this, we're all about it and planning that the hymns match and the texts all are arranged and that everything fits and it progresses to the end. But you guys have day jobs and maybe don't see all that. But we had this idea that at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, he goes into the wilderness for 40 days, if you recall that, where he is tempted by Satan. And we use that because that is the pattern of our Lenten season. Lent is 40 days, excluding the Sundays. It's 40 days from Ash Wednesday to today. And it represents simultaneously the Old Testament people of God wandering in the wilderness for 40 years and metaphorically also our lives, our whole life as we go through a time of temptation and testing. As Jesus did for us, with us, in the wilderness. The disciples, too. They had this time of training, these 3 years, and on Palm Sunday, they come marching in with Jesus, and they think, we're done. We're at the end. We're graduating. We're going to get cushy government jobs because Jesus is going to be king, and I'm going to be at his right hand, and I'm going to be at his left. No, I'll be at his right hand, but you can be minister of the interior, or I'll be the secretary of state when Jesus is king, right? Of course, it didn't turn out that way. It didn't happen that way, but they were at the end of their journey. They'd been through so many things, like us. In these last 6 weeks, we talked about how with Jesus in the wilderness, we've gone through sacrifice. Oh my, have we had sacrifice over this last year. The things that we have lost, the things that we have grieved, the people that we have lost. We have experienced anger and even rage and frustration. We've endured loneliness. Isolation and shame and humiliation. Over these last 6 weeks, we've talked about from God's word how our Lord has brought us through all these things at last to this time. Except you know that this isn't the end of the trail, right? I mean, it's wonderful. We come to Easter, we sing all these songs. But on Monday, it just keeps going on. And you're gonna still have these. You're gonna still be more isolated than you usually are. We're going to still be trying to work off the COVID-19 that we added. Going to be still, things are not right. So after Easter, this end of our journey, are we going to continue? Remember the little picture that we had of the guy going through the desert dragging his backpack? Is this us for the rest of your life? Is that what our journey is? How does our journey change because of Easter? Does our trip through life change as a result of this day? I would like to suggest to you that today is the beginning of a new trip, a new hike, a new adventure. Jesus says to his disciples, I should have read this verse, this is our text. Go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. This trail's a little different. Personally, I love setting out on a hike. I love everything about it. I like to go backpacking with my sons, and we've had several trips like this. We try to do it at least once a year if we can. Some years it hasn't worked out. But we go to different places, the Smoky Mountains or the Alleghenies, or we want to go places where you can do backcountry camping. None of this, you know, bringing your car to a campsite and unloading all of your inflatable everything and so on, and your music and your generator. We want to go out in the wilderness and be men, right? And so we prepare. The trips are all different, but the preparation is the same. We pick the location, and then we get out the trail maps, and we start to say, you know, which trails can we take? How many miles can we do in a day? Is this up a mountain, or is it down a mountain, or, you know, how hard is it going to be? And where's our campsites? And there's got to be water along the way, and we've got to put the trail segments together in such a way that they end up back at the car before our food runs out. So then we plan the menus, and we don't do this freeze-dried food stuff from Cabela's. We try to challenge ourselves to have real food, special meals, and pack just the right stuff, and make sure it's not too heavy, have just all the ingredients figured out, time them so that the ones that are perishable we eat on the early part of the trip, and we get this all figured out. We pack all the stuff. We make sure we're all carrying about the same amount of weight, except for me. I take a little lighter pack. John can handle it. And then we drive to the trailhead, and we get out. We lock the car, and then we get to there's usually a sign there by the trailhead, and we take a selfie picture. We're clean, and we're manly looking with our backpacks and all in our sticks, walking sticks. And off we go. And 4 days later, we're back in the same spot. After sleeping on the ground and walking mile after mile uphill and down with a heavy pack and cooking maybe in the rain, or maybe it was really cold, or maybe it was really hot, and all the mosquitoes. And by the time we get back, we want to take the before picture and the after picture at the trail marker, at the trailhead, but a lot of times we have forgotten the after picture because we get back and there's the car. And those seats are so comfortable after 4 days away. And we want to get to where there's cell service again. If somebody said to us right then, when we got back, when we just make it back to the car, if somebody said, how about we go for another 4 days? As much as I love backpacking, I think I would probably say, not yet. No thanks. But this is what Jesus is doing, isn't it? I mean, you've been coming along and coming along through this trip and this wilderness and dragging along your pack and enduring all this stuff. And he says, it's Easter. Now let's go again. This is a special kind of trip. I lost my place. I got to find where I'm at. So the women are invited on this trip. They come early to the trailhead. They've been packing the night before, just like us. They went out. You know, the tradition is that the Jewish day begins the evening before, actually, when the first star is visible in the night sky. And so the thing is, on a Sabbath day, you cannot buy and sell or do any work. So the shops are all closed. But when the first star becomes visible at that dusk, they can go out in a hurry and go to the market stalls, and they can buy all these many pounds of ointments and spices and fragrant things that they will anoint Jesus' body with. And so they have these pounds and pounds of burial spices. And early on Sunday morning then, they get up and they hike to the trailhead, to the tomb, that is. And they pack the wrong thing. They completely pack the wrong thing. This has happened to us where we packed a whole meal and then we forgot one thing that was critical, and we're carrying all this stuff and we can't use it because we don't have the one thing we have to have. They packed all this stuff and nobody needs burial spices because there's no body. There's nobody dead. So they have to leave that behind. The disciples, they didn't do any planning. They didn't do any packing. They come running to the tomb, and they don't know where they're going. Which way do we go? What are we going to do next? But Jesus has left a message for them. Like we might leave a note on the windshield of the car. If we had a group of other people and they were too slow, we'd say, well, we're going ahead. We'll meet you at the campsite or at the place we planned we would have lunch. You catch up with us. Jesus does that. He leaves more than a message. He leaves a messenger. Remember, messenger, the word for angel, angelos, means a messenger. Jesus leaves a messenger, an angel who says, go tell his disciples and Peter that he's going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. He'll meet you there. Jesus says, I'm off, guys. Come on. It's time to start a new journey. This one is different. Where does it start? You picture. Jesus has gone through this long wilderness journey and through all the ministry and through the challenges and through the suffering and the opposition, and he comes to Jerusalem and he has these interactions with his enemies. And then he is arrested and he's jailed and he's beaten and he's crucified and he dies, he's thrown into the tomb. Everything's over. But on Easter Sunday morning, Jesus takes a step. And in stepping out of the tomb, he is beginning something very different than what went before. In stepping out of the tomb and telling his disciples, now follow me, here's where we're going. This tomb of Jesus becomes our trailhead. Let's take a selfie real quick. We're at the beginning. Paul says, yours is very appropriate that we do that right here by the baptismal font. Paul says that when you were baptized, you were thrown into the grave with Jesus, and then you rose with him, and you set out on that path with him. But there's things you need to pack, things you don't need to pack. You don't need to bring 30 pounds of burial spices. You don't need to bring this preparation for death, because death is dead. All your grief. You don't need to drag your grief along with you of all your losses, because Paul says, oh death, where is your sting? You don't even hurt anymore. He says, he tells the Thessalonians, some of whom you love have gone ahead of you on this path. You can't see them now. But Paul says, you're not going to pass them up. You're not going to miss them. He reminds them that those who have died are with the Lord, and he will bring them with him when he comes to meet us. Our group will be back together again on the trail. You don't need to pack fear on this trip. When we go on backpacking, we take a big canister of the most potent bear pepper spray that I could find. I've had it for years. I'm wondering if it still works. I've never sprayed it. I've always been afraid to. It's got this, you know, like a safety thing. You have to pull the pin like a grenade and then squirt it with the trigger. super powerful. But I carried along because I'm not carrying a gun, and you're out there in the middle of nowhere, and you're laying there in your tent in the pitch dark. And I mean, it's dark, dark. And you hear somebody or something moving around outside your tent. I always want to make sure I lay my hand on it. I know where that is if I need to grab it. Peter says, you don't need that. You don't need to take fear with you on this journey. He says, we have God's prophetic word confirmed. What do you mean? It's confirmed because we've seen that God fulfilled all his promises. Jesus, after all the worst of things happened, Jesus undid it all. He rose from the dead. And so all the promises that God made of the Savior who would come, they're all completed. And therefore, he says, pay attention to it as to a light in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. When it's dark on this trail, you have the word of God confirmed and made more sure for you. It is a light in a dark place until the sun rises again at last. You don't need to drag your guilt along with you. All of the mistakes you made in the past, all the things you failed to do. John says, if anybody sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is there to advocate for us before God's throne. He is the covering over of all our sins. You don't have to be afraid about getting lost. I don't know, the trail goes this way, and it goes that way, and it branches here. And what if I pick the wrong one? You have felt this last year like you've been wandering in circles in the wilderness. And it seemed like, oh, it's going to be bad. And then the curve is going up. And then, oh, it's going down. Oh, now it's going up again. Oh, it's going down. Oh, now it's going. And what do we do? Where do we go? How do we decide? We're exhausted by it. But Jesus has given you the perfect GPS. His Holy Spirit that speaks to you through his word. He knows your location at all times. And he knows, he guides your steps toward your destination to be with Jesus. This is your destination, to be with Jesus. I know you're tired. Boy, I know you're tired. But Jesus has packed strengthening food for you. The perfect thing. It's even very lightweight. This bread and this wine, by them, he feeds you with his body and his blood to give you life when you feel like you're dead. I'm going ahead of you, he said. But I will come back and take you to be with me where I am. Come. This is our new journey. And it is a wonderful one. It may at times be steep. It may at times seem narrow. But it began at Jesus' empty grave. And it will go on until it reaches your empty grave. Just as his grave was empty, your grave also will be empty. Because Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And he says, follow me. Amen. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's stand up and sing in response to God's word.
Thank you.
risen Christ, we laud and worship you for defeating death and the grave. For you are the first fruits of those who have died. Help us to keep you first in our life of faith and trust in you as the victor who goes before. Let us never put ourselves before you, but give of ourselves first to you and then to one another. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Like the women who came early to the tomb, we are often filled with fear and worry about the future. Roll away all that keeps us from drawing near to you and trusting in you fully. Fill us with confidence and peace in knowing that you will never leave us nor forsake us. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
As Easter people, compel us to spread joy and share the saving news of your death and resurrection with all whom we meet. Let us be your ambassadors of hope to the hurting, bringing release to the captive and joy to the downcast. May we live as your new creations, bringing honor and glory only to you. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Bring new life to the unity of spirit in our church community. Bind us as one in our efforts to live as your forgiven and redeemed people who reach out in love to our neighbors. Rid us of any divisions and help us support one another in our common goal of making you known to the world around us. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Revive in us a sense of purpose in our walk with you. Bring energy to our lives of prayer. May our reading of Scripture open new insights to your grace. May our worship be truly engaging and meaningful. May it be pleasing to you. Let our interactions here and everywhere reflect genuine care rooted in you. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Keep our focus on the new life that is yet to come, your paradise to come. You are the first fruits of the resurrection to come. Never let us be so distracted by the experiences of this earth that we fail to remember we're awaiting a new heaven and a new earth where there will be no more sin, no more tears, no more pain, where you will be seated on the throne of heaven forevermore. Christ is risen. As we await that great day, be with those who struggle here on earth with sickness and injury, grief and pain. Instill in them a reliance on your grace and mercy and dependence on your good and gracious will for them. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
These prayers we offer in the name of our risen Savior Jesus Christ, who did the will of God, and who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Even on this high festival day, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, we confess that we have not remained strong in faith. We have not always let the sure news of your resurrection dispel the fear that wells up within us. We have thought, spoken, and acted in weakness. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We deserve your judgment in time and eternity. Forgive us and renew us, the sure hope joining saints and angels around the eternal feast which you have prepared for all who call your Son their Savior and Lord. Amen. By his suffering and death, our Lord has paid for our sins. And by his rising, he has destroyed the power of death forever. Therefore, by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I, as a called and ordained servant of our risen and triumphant Savior Jesus Christ, forgive you for all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Lift up your hearts.
Let us
give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and proper that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For you have revealed to us the life-saving message of the gospel, grounded in the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. On this day, we praise you for displaying your power over the grave in Jesus' rising to life, and we eagerly anticipate the rising of all your saints at our Savior's return. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And after he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please stand. The true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you, body and soul, to life everlasting. Depart with Easter joy. I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last he will stand upon the earth. Whom I shall see for myself. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. After we sing, I Know That My Redeemer Lives, our postlude will be the Hallelujah Chorus. We welcome you to stay and sing along as we do that postlude. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.